greet you all in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I'd like to welcome you to this ceremony online service this morning, Sunday, the 4th of July, 2021. Shall we bow our heads for a word of prayer? Our most gracious Heavenly Father, we want to thank you, Lord God Almighty, for this opportunity that we are here alive, dear God, Lord God Almighty, and also alive, Father, dear Jesus Christ, in this world pandemic that has shaken the economies, political stabilities, and Father, that also has removed believers from the place of their joy, which is the church. Dear God, we know that, Father, in church is where we enjoy our worship together in one accord. In church, dear Father, is where we listen. Heavenly Father and dear God, support in any way granted, Father, Lord God Almighty, to your word. Father, in church, that's where many of us got our blessings. In church, some even got married. In church, Father, some were healed. But dear God, today, we are in our homes, Father, locked down once more, second year running, dear God, because of the pandemic that is going across the world. Heavenly Father, destroying lives, destroying the health of people. Dear God, we are thankful that, gracious God, at least there's still breath of life in our souls, in our bodies. Dear Father, that gracious God, opportunity to hear your word, as well as, Father, not only hearing your word, but also, God, to put our lives right for the glory of the kingdom of heaven. Father, we kindly ask that you may forgive our trespasses, our errors, and our shortcomings as we, dear Father, present this same, Lord God Almighty, and that we believe that, gracious God, you will be the inspiration behind this service. So we kindly ask, Lord, in Christ Jesus' name we pray, amen. Praise God. There is a precious hiding place in Jesus' sight. Oh, in Jesus' sight, there is a place of heavenly grace. In Jesus' sight, in Jesus' sight, there is a place. Sin and from all doubt, all the world may enter in. Precious place in Jesus' sight. Precious brothers and sisters, I welcome you to this online service, and I would ask that we can open our Bibles this morning to the books of Psalms. We are going to start from the 81st chapter, verse 15. Psalms 81, verse 15. The Bible says, "The haters of God should have submitted themselves unto him, but their time should have endured forever. Fed them also with the finest of the wheat and with honey out of the rock, should I have satisfied thee." Now, today our main subject will be wild honey in the rock. And for a theme today, we are saying the promises of God are conditional. Praise God. Repeat again. Hallelujah. Wild honey in the rock being the subject this morning. And the theme that we are going to try and carry out will be the promises of God are conditional. Now, I trust you'll understand very well that this is not the way we are used to preach. This is more like a speech, but we understand also in the Bible that the Lord Jesus Christ, several times, he sat on the rock and preached the Beatitudes. He sat down in the temple and referred to the scripture in the book of Isaiah when he was talking about the scripture being fulfilled in that day. So today we'll try by all means to just speak from this little desk here as we are looking first in the scriptures and maybe one or two quotes from the prophet as we look at the subject, wild honey in the rock, and the promises of God are conditional. Now, I'm sure people will wonder, how do we come to that? How do we come to a subject where we say wild honey in the rock? It is simply because there is a lot of honey that is found in the shelves of our shops today. But if you are going to take the bottle and read the ingredients, you are going to see that it's no longer the wild raw honey that we used to eat in the bushes, especially us from a very rich rural background. We enjoyed original food and we enjoyed honey that comes from the honeycomb. And it's way different because this one is endowed with a lot of sugar syrups. Though it tastes like honey, but it's no longer original honey. But here we are talking about the original wild honey that is found in a honeycomb. And for a subject, we are saying the promises of God are conditional. Now, I'm sure to kick off the scriptures today, I don't want to waste or spend much of your time, as I have taught myself that I will try to be very, very timeous to save you on data and also on time. Hallelujah. So from the book of Psalms where we read, the Bible is actually looking at the people who hated God and saying the haters of the Lord should have submitted themselves unto him. Praise God, which means those who were against God should have submitted to him. It would have been better for their lives. It should have been honey in the rock for them if they had chosen to submit themselves to the Lord. And he says, but their time should have endured forever. They could have lived forever. They could have not died. Like the Bible says, we do not die, but we have passed from death unto life. The Bible goes on to say, he should have fed them also with the finest of the wheat, which means God was going to bless them with the finest of wheat if they had submitted themselves unto him. Hallelujah. And with honey out of the rock should have I. Now God takes over from the prophet. He is no longer allowing the prophet to speak. He is taking over. He says, should I have satisfied? And with honey out of the rock should I have satisfied thee? So now God is actually directly speaking to those people who chose to hate him. And he's saying, I had honey in my hand. I had honey from the rock to give you. But because you hated me and you did not submit yourselves to me, therefore I could not give you honey from the rock. I could not give you the finest of the wheat. Praise God. So this honey of the rock, this not honey from the bottle of spa, not honey from the shop right, or honey from, but this is honey from the rock. The real wild honey was in God's hand. And we have never had any side effects of raw honey. We have had a lot of side effects when it comes to the sugars that we eat. We now understand that many of the things that we have consumed in life until today are actually detrimental to our health. But raw honey or wild honey has never been found to be of any detrimental effects to our bodies. The sweetest thing, if you would look at the promises of God to the children of Israel, they were promised that if they would enter into the land of milk and honey, which was Canaan, it was about milk, it was about honey that God was using constantly to remind the children of Israel about the land that he was giving unto them. Praise God. So today we are just looking at this issue and we are saying this honey in the rock, this wild honey in the rock is actually, hallelujah, praise God, is actually a blessing. And these blessings are actually conditional. These promises are actually conditional. Now, let us go again for a scripture reading, friends. Whilst we are in the comfort of our homes, driving or at work, let us look again to the book of Deuteronomy, the 32nd chapter, Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 9. The Bible says, for the Lord's portion in his people, Jacob, is the lot of his inheritance. Praise God. So Jacob, which is Israel, was God's inheritance. He says, he found him in a desert and in a waste, howling wildness or wilderness. He led him about, he instructed him, he kept him as the apple of his eye. Now, God is, actually, I've watched this in the Old Testament, that God always come back to remind us where he took us, where he found us. Some of us, he found us in the lowest type of lives. We were not rich in the sense of financial riches, material riches. You know, he picked us from where we were nothing, we had nothing. Hallelujah. Sometimes unemployed, sometimes poor, sometimes in various difficulties. But God will always lift us up. But one thing that God does, when he has lifted us up and we start to backtrack, like what most of us do, God will always call us to remembrance, to where he called us out, and then to where he has set us, where he found us. He also spoke the same of David. He also spoke the same of Israel. And now we find in this scripture here, God is actually reminding Israel that I found you in a desert land. I found you in the waste, howling in the wilderness. He says, he led him about. He instructed him. He kept him as the apple of his eye, as an eagle steereth his nest. Hallelujah. Fluttereth over her young, spreadeth abroad her wings, taketh them breath from breath them on her wings. Then on verse 12 he says, so the Lord alone did lead him, and there was no strange God with him. So God actually had to take Israel, to lead Israel on his own. There was no strange God in Israel that was actually leading them, except the Lord, their God, whom is the Lord of Israel, or the God of Israel that we worship today. That's why our religion is connected to Israel, because we believe in the God of Israel. So the Bible says on verse 18, he made him ride on the high places of the earth, that he might eat the increase of the fields. And he made him to suck honey out of the rock, and oil out of the flinty rocks, butter of kine, and milk of sheep, with fat of the lamb, and ram of the bread of Bashan, and goats with the fat of kidneys of wheat. And thou didst drink the pure blood of the grape. So God actually, when he took Israel, and as long as God was leading Israel on his own, the Bible tells us that God led them into places where Israel was actually enjoying the good of the land. Israel was eating the increase of the fields. Israel was sucking from the wild honey, hallelujah, out of the rock. Israel was drinking or using oil out of the flint of the rock. Israel was using the butter of kine and the milk of sheep with the fat of lambs, which means God was continuously feeding the children of Israel as long as they followed after his word. Now, the Bible goes on. If you are going to read further on, if you have your only time, just because of the sake of this little hour that we have, if you have got time, I would ask you to continue reading from verse 15 going downwards. You are going to realize that God eventually saw, after feeding them, after doing all the good things unto them, then they started to look for other gods to worship. And as soon as they did that, God withdrew his blessings. Praise God. So this in on its own is a subject. Israel is a subject that we can look into the Old Testament, and we can actually say, surely Israel was actually a blessed nation. At one time, they were eating the manna from the wilderness. Hallelujah. Which was prepared on the tables of God. The next thing, we find out that they were drinking water from the rock, because God was their leader. Whilst they were in the wilderness, they never longed for any dress. They never looked for any industry to produce. God was mending himself the dresses, the garments of the children of Israel. God was giving increase. He was actually the doctor in their midst. He was healing them. Praise the Lord. We hear that even the 120 old men would die young because he had the strength of a young man. Even Moses, when he was 120 years, he had the strength of a young man because God was their doctor. God was in their midst. So as long as God was in the midst of the children of Israel, they never wanted. That's why I'm sure the Bible says in the book of Psalms 23, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." The great prophet David, he says, "He leadeth me to green pastures, and he makes a table before mine own enemies." As long as the Lord was his shepherd, he was not wanting. As long as the Lord was his shepherd, he was being led to green pastures. As long as the Lord was his shepherd, he was being taken to still waters. As long as the Lord was his shepherd, praise God, he was enjoying. He could even eat before the enemies. When everyone was swearing that he is going to die, they are going to finish him, David would see the table spread before his own enemies. And they would die because of stress, because he was continuously blessed. Blessed is a man who keeps the words of the living God. Hallelujah. I want also to take you, as I am just not going to spend much time talking today, being a subject that we are reading, studying, hallelujah, provoking. It's something that people have neglected in our day. And if you look at our Pentecostal message today, it's a Pentecostal message of prosperity, but it's prosperity in a wrong way. The Bible tells us that God does not prosper the wicked. God prospers his children. So the prosperity of God is what we are talking about today. We were having a discussion last Sunday after the sermon we preached here, and we were saying if people in the world had realized that giving tithes to church would bring instant blessings, people would have stopped businesses and brought money into church so that they can reap a lot of money out of that money. But God does not work that way. That's why when you bring your tithes to the Lord, you'll have to wait until such a time when God has proven your faith and blesses you. If it was like that, all these people who are in the drug dealings would have stopped drug dealing and put money in church so that they can get blessings, because they are looking for money. But God does not work that way. God has a special way of his own working. Praise God. Now let us listen to this man called Jehoshaphat. Jehoshaphat was one of those kings that the prophet loved so much. And, you know, he had his mistakes, hallelujah, by associating with Ahab and house of Jezebel, which ended up in his son getting married to Athaliah. But, you know, God loved Jehoshaphat. God blessed Jehoshaphat and his kingdom until such a time when his child made a mistake that Ahab did to marry a Jezebel. Now, let us read here from the book of 2 Chronicles, chapter 20, verse 14. 2 Chronicles chapter 20 verse 14, the Bible says, "Then upon Jehaziel, the son of Zechariah, the son of Benaiah, the son of Jeriel, the son of Mattaniah, a Levite, of the son of Asaph, came the Spirit of the Lord in the midst of the congregation." Now, in this subject here, if you are writing this scripture down, you can go and read the whole chapter. The children of Israel under or the Jews or the children of Judah under the leadership of Jehoshaphat were preparing to go for a war. And then Jehoshaphat was very keen. As we know, one time he told Ahab that we can't go to fight the Golden Heights unless we inquire of the Lord. It was the doing of Jehoshaphat, the king. That's why God loved him so much, because in everything that he do, he was trying by all means to inquire from the Lord, because he knew there was a blessing in the word of the Lord. And now here, what we see, now after inquiring, the congregation went to sing in prayer, hallelujah, and then God answered the requests of Jehoshaphat. And the Holy Ghost came down upon Jehaziel, the son of Zechariah, who was of the house of Asaph. And the Bible says, "And he said, Hearken, ye all Judah, and ye inhabitants of Jerusalem, and thou King Jehoshaphat, thus saith the Lord unto you, Be not afraid nor dismayed, by reason of this great multitude, for the battle is not yours, but God's battle. So, you know, Jehoshaphat did not just walk out to go into the war because his character or his behavior, he put God first. He loved God and he wanted God, he wanted to know the opinion of God. And there was a multitude of army that was against him. And today, what shall we say? Let's say there was corona, there was tuberculosis. Now, you know, HIV and all, now they are talking about heat waves, global warming, typhoons, and all these kind of enemies of our day that we're standing before Jehoshaphat. And today we are the children of Judah. We are the children of Jerusalem, the new Jerusalem. And there's many things that encompasses us. Economic issues, job problems, business collapsing problems. Hallelujah, you know, family problems, marital issues. Hallelujah, child delinquencies and many other things that we face in today. But you know, Jehoshaphat, whilst he was faced by the multitude of problems that were before him, he inquired of the Lord what to do. He never went on his own decision, which was is now a problem in our day because we are not no longer a word acquainted people, but we are now a people who are seeking after just the blessings, not the God of the blessings. I think this is a saying that is going around in the world today, that people love the gifts of God, not the giver of the gifts. So Jehoshaphat loved God and he wanted to know the opinion of God on every matter that he faced as a king. And here the God was now replying. Hallelujah. He was telling them not to be afraid. And now in the verse 16, the Bible says, tomorrow go ye down against them. Behold, they come up by the cliff of Ziz. Now, God actually, in his people, he was actually giving them direction, even of how the enemy will come. Hallelujah. I'm sure in the message of the hour, we are a blessed people that we all even knew beforehand that it will come a time there will be diseases incurable. God advising his people. When God is in the midst of the people and the people are following God, God is bound to advise them, give them direction of how to walk and what to face and how to face the challenges of their day. What do we see here? He says, and ye shall find them at the end of the brook before the wilderness of Jeruel. Verse 17, he says, ye shall not need to fight this in this battle. Set yourselves, stand ye still, and see the salvation of the Lord with you. O Judah and Jerusalem, fear not, and be dismayed. Tomorrow, go out against them, for the Lord will be with you. Praise God. Every time the children of Israel were in good relationship with God, they did not even need to fight wars for themselves. God was actually the warrior, the captain of the horse. Never a time did they ever lose any battle when God was on their side. Hallelujah. That's why we are saying today the promises of God are conditional. As long as God was in Israel, and as long as Israel were following God, they were never defeated. That's why one day when they got defeated during the reign of Moses as the prophet, they actually asked themselves, why has it happened that way that we are defeated? And they casted lots, and they found out that Achan had stolen the Babylonian garment which God had said we, the children of Israel, were not supposed to have stolen. So it is a very important thing that as children of God, we continue to follow God in all what we do, with all that we can. Praise God. Love God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your strength, with everything that you are. Love him. That is the very first commandment. We should love God. We should follow his precepts. The Bible says he shall be precept upon precept. He shall be line upon line. Hallelujah. Here little, there little, according to the prophecies of God. Praise God. So now, God was telling them, fear not, nor be dismayed. Tomorrow, go out against them. The Lord will be with you. If there is anything that we need today, is God to be with us. And God can only be with us if we keep His word, if we follow His word, if we believe in His word, then we shall be licking honey, wild honey from the rock. We shall be drinking the milk of the plenteous milk of the land of Canaan. Praise the Lord. Listen to Jehoshaphat on verse 20. And they rose in the early morning and went forth into the wilderness of Tekoa. And as they went forth, Jehoshaphat stood and said, he loved God. When he saw God working these miracles in their midst, God speaking back to them, God advising them of how to attack the enemy, Jehoshaphat was so inspired that when the troop were marching towards the enemy, he stood in the wilderness of Tekoa and he said these words, "Hear me, O Judah, hear inhabitants of Jerusalem, believe in the Lord your God, and so shall ye be established." Many of us, we want to be established. Many of us, we have a lot of requests that are lined up. Some are written in Bible. Some are written on New Year's Eve. Some are resolutions that we have wrote and pasted on our walls. Some are embedded in the hearts of people. They want God to do this. They want God to do that. They want God to bless them with this. They want God to bless them with that. Praise God. I also have resolutions. I also have things that I'm praying for. Hallelujah. I trust the same with my wife, the same with my family as well. Praise God. I believe each and every one of families, they have a list of things that they are seeking from God. Some are seeking financial recognition. Some are seeking blessings. Hallelujah. Different types, physical, spiritual. Praise God. Hallelujah. Children. Hallelujah. Houses. Some they need cars. Praise God. Some are looking for the Holy Ghost. Praise the Lord. Some are seeking for salvation of their souls. But listen very careful. The Bible says if you want to be established, if you want to be established in the Holy Ghost land, believe your God. Listen to this other statement that he did not leave. He says, believe his prophets, so ye shall prosper. Praise God. We are living in a day when people think that when they come from a Bible school, they know it all. Some they have studied the prophet's messages. Some they have, gone over to study, historical books. And now they know a little more than prophets. We have seen of late people turning against the prophet. I want to assure you, precious brother and sister, that there is no prosperity outside believing God's prophets. Something somewhere is going to strike you down. You will not make it. I still remember there was a time when the mother of the prophet had a dream way back in the early ministry of the prophet. Brother Branham was one of those preachers who preached about, hallelujah, the three stages of salvation, which is justification, sanctification, and baptism of the Holy Ghost. And he would elaborate it in steps. And the prophet preached against the high heels, makeups, and all things. And the mother of the prophet had a dream of a woman who was wearing high-heeled shoes, all makeup, who decided to disrespect the prophet and ignore the prophet and tried to walk the three steps. Sure, the first step, she was successful. The second step, she was successful. And she went on to the third step. And as she started on the journey, the prophet's mother had a long cry and a hard fall from the woman who had disrespected the prophet in the preaching of high heels and makeups. It's true that you might go on and say there is no scripture in the Bible where the Bible ever said women should not dress high heels or make makeup. It's okay. You can do that. But remember the dream of Mama Branham when she had a dream of that woman who went the three steps but fell into oblivion. And today, those people who dare to stand against God's vindicated prophets, and especially today, God has blessed us with the message of the hour, with a prophet, William Marion Branham, there is not going to be a success, but a hard fall. Brother, sister, limp in the message. Brother, sister, stay with the message. Try hard to stay in line, no matter how it takes, no matter how it costs. Praise God. And when he has consulted with the people, he appointed singers unto the Lord, and that should praise the beauty of holiness as they went out before the army. and so say, and to say, praise the Lord, for his mercy endureth forever. Verse 22, and when they began to sing and to praise, the Lord set ambushments against the children of Ammoni, Moab, and Mount Seir, which were come against Judah, and they were smitten. So it wasn't God, it wasn't the children of Israel or the army that was fighting. It was God fighting because he was in the midst of his people. The story was not the same with the children of Israel. They were in a beating all the time because of the teaching of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat. Brother, sister, I love one thing about Jehoshaphat. Even though we can pick his mistakes, we can say, why did he align with this? Why did he talk to this? Why did he visit this? Why did he make an alignment with this one? But Jehoshaphat taught Judah to respect God's word and also to respect God's prophet. And during his reign, in Jehoshaphat's time, the children of Israel or the children of Judah were never beaten down. God fought for them. God actually set ambushments where he made ambush and he killed these three kings who had united against the children of Judah. Now, brother, sister, if you are a reader of the Bible, you'll know that this is not the first and this was not the last time where God fought for himself, where God fought for his people, where God went out before his people and killed. I still remember in one scripture, God actually went down and he caused rocks to fall from heaven to kill an army which had come against Israel. Those who were running away somewhere just found themselves hanging on stumps. Three stumps could actually defeat the children or the enemies of Israel, because God said in the Bible that the enemies of Abraham shall be the enemies of God, and the blessers of Abraham shall also be the blessers of God. Hallelujah. But it was always on condition that they loved and listened and followed God and God alone. So now, I would want to, take you a little bit further on the book of Deuteronomy. The book of Deuteronomy was written as a farewell. Actually, it is said that Moses preached the book of Deuteronomy in three sermons, just before he went to stand on the rock where he was pegged and buried by angels. And no man ever saw his grave. The only people who later saw Moses were John, James, and Peter when they were standing on Mount Transfiguration before the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. So the book of Deuteronomy was actually three sermons. And it was a farewell addressed by Moses to the Israelites before they entered the promised land of Canaan. The speeches, if you are going to read the book of Deuteronomy, the speeches that constitute this address recall Israel's past, which means where Israel came from. And as we are on this journey, brother, sister, we must never forget where we came from. Sometimes when we get rich, we forget where we came from. Sometimes when we start to earn a little bit more, buy better suits, stay in better houses, sleep on better beds, we start to forget where we come from. Sometimes, when we get educated, we forget where we came from. Many things, when our children are doing well abroad, wherever it might be, we start to forget where we come from. That's why people ridicule one another, look down upon one another, scorn and laugh at each other. But if we are very careful, listen to every preacher who will preach under the same spirit of Moses, we will always remind people of where they came from. And also, reiterates the law that Moses had communicated to the people at Horeb. So the preaching of Moses, the second part, was to reiterate what God had given to them as a law. That's what we are doing this morning. We are doing nothing more but just to reiterate what God said we must do. Praise the Lord. Sometimes we fail, sometimes we limp, but we must have high hopes that we are going to do it anyhow. Praise God. So we reiterate the law of Moses. We reiterate the Bible. We reiterate the teaching of the apostles. We reiterate the teaching of the Lord Jesus Christ. We reiterate the teaching of the prophet William Marion Branham that God gave us as a storehouse. Hallelujah. Laws that Moses had communicated to the people at Horeb, at Sinai, and emphasized that observance of this law is essential for the well-being of the people in the land they are about to possess. So it was only the well-being of the children of Israel was based on their ability to observe the law that was given to them by God at Sinai in the mountain, which is called also the mountain of God in the desert of Arabia. Hallelujah. The title Deuteronomy, derived from Greek, does mean a copy or a repetition. So don't you get worried when we repeat what the Bible says. We are not doing nothing else. We did not come. A preacher is a eunuch according to the teaching of the prophet. A eunuch does not have his own word, hallelujah, or his own seed. He only repeats what the Bible says. He only repeats what the tape says. So never get annoyed when we repeat what the tape says, because that's where we are. That's what we are called to do. There was only one prophet, and that was Moses. And actually, the Bible says Moses was like God to them. And then, hallelujah, Aaron, who was a priest, whose office is almost an office of a pastor or a preacher, his duty was to say to the congregation what the stammering Moses was saying to him. To repeat, it is a copy. What Aaron was saying was a copy of what Moses had said. And if you know, when Aaron did what Moses did not say, do you know what he did? He made a calf of gold, which God was not happy, and people died, was smitten. So the preacher's job is not to start a new thing, but it's a copy, a repetition. Even the prophet was repeating. Even the Lord Jesus Christ, when he came, he was only reading from the Bible. We see when he took a copy, he read from the book of Isaiah. Hallelujah. At one time, he was referring to what Moses said, what the prophet Jeremiah said, what the prophet David said. In all this, brother, sister, the preaching of the gospel is a repetition. The three sermons of Moses were a repetition. Hallelujah. Listen to Deuteronomy chapter 28. I've got some few more minutes here. Let's read it together. Brother, sister, as you are listening this morning, I want you to be assured in our homes that there is no prosperity outside observance of the word of the living God. There is no wild honey in the rock, except we are keen in our hearts, we are keen in our souls to follow that which the Lord God has actually said. Whilst I'm still there, I still remember one time when the children of Israel were going to war in the book of Judges. Hallelujah. There was a man called Gideon, whom the angel of the Lord had appeared, and he gave them instructions according to what God had said to him. And the children of Israel, as long as they obeyed what God had spoken to Gideon, they prospered. And as they were going to fight, I love what they said. They were calling out. They said, "The sword of the Lord and the sword of Gideon." And brother, sister, here we are holding the Bible and we are holding the quotation as well. The sword of the Lord, the sword of William Branham, the sword of the Lord, the sword of Malachi 4:5. Because the Bible tells us that if we, God was not going to send Malachi 4:5 into this earth, then God was going to smite the earth with a curse. We have to know what this man was picking. Hallelujah. Praise God. Revelation 10:7. In the days of the voice of the seventh angel, when he began to sound, we have to hold fast to the voice of the seventh angel. I believe with all my heart that any teaching that is contrary to the voice of the seventh angel is a voice of dissent, is a voice of the enemy, is the voice of the devil. No matter how good people may be, no matter how precious they are to our hearts, but as long as they are speaking against the message of the hour, they are not of God. Hallelujah. We pray for them and we still love them. Deuteronomy chapter 28 verse 1, it says, "And it shall come to pass, if thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and to do all his commandments, which I command thee this day, that the Lord thy God will set thee on high above all nations of the earth." We want God's blessings, but the blessings of God are conditional. The Bible is saying, if thou shalt hearken, not just hearken, but diligently, which means to hearken is to listen, to love, and to follow diligently, rigidly, unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and to do all his commandments, which I command thee this day, that the Lord thy God will set thee above all nations of the earth. And all these blessings, hallelujah, shall come to thee. They are coming to thee. Why? Because you have hearkened diligently and you have set yourself to observe and to do all his commandments. Hallelujah. And these blessings shall come on thee and overtake thee, and thou shalt hearken unto the voice. If thou shalt hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, blessed shalt thou be in the city, and blessed shalt thou be in the fields. It does not matter whether you are staying in the rural areas or you are staying in a town. As long as you hearken diligently to the voice of God, and you set yourself to observe and to do all his commandments, then God has got no other option but to fulfill his word, because he keeps his word. You know, I could have put thousands of quotations, where Brother Branham says, God keeps his word. God has always kept his word. God will always stand behind his word. But the problem is, we are the ones who always leave the place that God can bless us. Praise God. So if you are listening from the rural areas, I'm saying, listen, God says, he did not say he will bless those in town only. He said he will bless even in the fields, which is the rural area. So no matter where you are, no matter who you are, no matter where you come from, as long as you hearken diligently to the voice of God and you set your heart to do, to observe and to do according to all that he has commanded, you are a blessed man. Stand up and say, I am blessed this morning. Hallelujah. Listen to what he says. He says, blessed shall be the fruits of thy body. Hallelujah. Blessed shall be the fruit of thy ground. If you plant, you are going to reap. And the fruit of thy cattle, if you will have you will be blessed. They will be a twins. They will bless you so much. Hallelujah. The increase of thy kine and the flocks of thy sheep. Blessed shall be thy basket and thy store. Everything. Even the Bible actually says to those, you know, many a times, you know, people, they cry and they complain a lot about God not blessing them, about God not blessing them financially. You know, they murmur a lot. But, you know, there is a simple, one of the simple things that I've seen people, you know, local and far off, they don't believe in tithing at all. And, you know, tithing is part of what God said we should do. And the Bible says, if you are going to tithe, God is actually going to stop the devourer from your storehouse. You will not go hungry. If you store your food, God will become a preservative to the food that you store. If you've got your money in the bank, God is going to keep your money. God is going to keep your stuff. God is going to keep your household. God is going to keep your possession. But many people, they like God to do that, but without them fulfilling the part of what God has asked them to do. That's the challenge. That's why I'm preaching this message. The promises of God are conditional. Praise God. The Bible says, give, and it shall be given unto you. How I understand, people who are stingy, they are the people who want to be given most. They will get angry. They will get annoyed if they don't get or ask. When they ask and don't get, they will be very angry, but they don't want to give. The Bible says, blessed is he that giveth. It is a law that you should understand that, you know, for you to receive, it's in the Bible. But many people want to receive, but they don't want to give. They cannot even help a person in their lives. They will find reasons to run away from helping. They will find reasons to run away from assistance. But I want to tell you today that when you have set your heart to diligently follow God and all that he teaches, observe and to do it, God will bless thy basket, will bless thy store, He will bless. Blessed shalt thou be when you comest in. Blessed shalt thou be when you goest out. Hallelujah. The Lord shall cause thine enemies that rise against thee to be smitten before thy face. They shall come against thee one way and flee before thee seven ways. But remember, this is very true. This is correct. But remember, it is based on your attitude towards the word of God and your actions towards the word of the living God. That's what will bring these things to pass. The Lord shall command the blessings upon thee in thy storehouses. God is concerned about your bank account. God is concerned about your storehouse, where you put your food. God is concerned, hallelujah, and he, in all that thou settest thy hand unto. God is concerned about everything that you do with your hands. He shall bless thee in the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. The Lord shall establish thee an holy people unto himself, and he hath sworn unto thee, as he hath sworn unto thee, if thou shalt keep the commandments of the Lord thy God and walk in his way. Precious brother, sister, hallelujah, praise God. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all things shall be added unto you. If thou shalt keep the commandments of the Lord thy God and walk in his ways. Verse 10, and all the people of the earth shall see that thou art called by the name of the Lord, and they shall be afraid of thee. You want witches to be afraid of thee? Just follow and hearken and observe and do what the Lord has said. And the Lord shall make thee plenteous in goods, in the fruit of thy body, and in the fruit of thy cattle, and in the fruit of thy ground, and in the land which the Lord sware unto thy fathers to give thee. The Lord shall open unto thee his good treasures, the heaven to give the rain unto thy land in his season, and to bless all the work of thine hands. And thou shalt lend unto many nations, and thou shalt not borrow. These are all, hallelujah, blessings, promise of God. On verse 18, and the Lord shall make thee head and not the tail. The Lord, and thou shalt be above only, and thou shalt not be beneath. You will be managers at work. Hey, but some people are not, they don't even respect the managers at work. And that is a prerequisite of a Christian. He says, to the one that you work for, submit yourself even as you submit to God. So how can you become a manager when you are so disrespectful? When you are always, you are the union leader in your work. You are the one who leads revolts at work. No, it does not work. The Bible does not teach us as children of God. We are blessed in our meekness. We are blessed in our humility. We are blessed in our gentleness. Not when we become wolves. Not when we become lions. We are not blessed in those respects. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. He says here, and you shall make thee head and not tail, and thou shalt be above only, thou shalt not be beneath. If thou hearken unto the commandment of the Lord thy God, which I command thee this day, to observe and to do them, and thou shalt not go aside from any of the words which I command thee this day, to the right or to the left, hallelujah, to go after other gods, to serve them. Don't you try them apostolic people. Don't try sangomas. Just walk in and follow God. All the things that you are looking for, they'll come to pass. But you know, you have to be patient. Hallelujah. You have to be long-suffering. All those things are found in the word of the living God. You have to have faith in him. My, praise God. Verse 15, but it shall come to pass, if thou wilt not hearken unto the voice of the Lord. If you have got time, precious brother, sister, I want you to read again Deuteronomy chapter 28. You are going to see the both sides of the story. The hearkening side and the disrespecting side. Hallelujah. if you hearken, if thou will not hearken unto the voice of the Lord to observe and to do all his commandments and his statutes, which I command thee this day, that all these cases shall come upon thee. So not hearkening invites cases. Hearkening invites blessings. That's why we are saying the promises of God are conditional. Their wild honey in the rock is conditional. Hallelujah. Even rapture is conditional. Even the baptism of the Holy Ghost is conditional. Even salvation is conditional. Every promise of God is conditional. So don't you ever just run like what we see, you know, our precious friends in the Pentecostal realms. They just believe that if they give God money, they are blessed. That's not it. The blessings of God are conditional. Now listen, if you choose not to obey God and to run a course that is contrary to God, you are cursed. Hallelujah. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth shall have eternal life, shall not die, shall not perish. He says, but he who does not believe is condemned already. Which means without whatever good thing you try to do outside believing Jesus Christ, you are condemned. There is no prosperity in a condemned person. Oh, hallelujah. Praise God. And I trust you understand that. That it just the beginning of it, the onion mark, get ready, go of it, is meant when you believe in the only begotten Son of the Father. And if you don't, the Bible says, all these cases shall come upon thee. Have you ever seen people who believe in riches through sangomas, how their children end up in various type of sicknesses? You know, funny things happening. People who subscribe to sangomas, they are always up in it. Sometimes they end up dressing in dressing codes that are funny. They are under a curse because they fail to believe in the word of the living God. They are under a curse. The Bible says, and all these curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee. Cursed shall thou be in the city. Even if you go to a city, you shall be cursed. Cursed shall thou be in the field, even if you are in farming, you shall be cursed. Cursed shall thy be thy basket, thy store. Cursed shall be the fruit of thy body, the fruit of thy land, the increase of the kine in the flocks of thy sheep. Cursed shall thou be when thou comest in. Cursed shall thou be when thou goest out. What an excommunication that God is giving to a person who has refused to listen to his. The Lord God shall send upon thee, causing vexation and rebuke, and in all thou settest thine hands unto for to do, until thou be destroyed, until thou perish quickly because of the wickedness of thy doing, when whereby thou hast forsaken me. The Lord shall make the pestilences cleave unto thee, until he have consumed thee from off the land whither thou goest to possess. Anything that you are trying to do, God will just continuously conflict you. The Lord shall smite thee with a consumption, and with a fever, and with an inflammation, and with an extreme burning, and with the sword, with the blasting, and with the mild dew, and they shall pursue thee until thou perish. My. Hallelujah. You can go on and go on and go on and go on. What does the Bible say? In the book of Isaiah, the first chapter, verse 18, God says through the prophet Isaiah, come now, not tomorrow, come now, let us reason together. Say the Lord, though your sins be as scarlet as red, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wood, wool, whiteness of wool. Verse 19, if ye be willing and obedient, ye shall eat the good of the land. Hallelujah. The promises of God are conditional. If ye be willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. Verse 20, the other side. But if ye refuse and rebel, ye shall be devoured with the sword, for the mouth of the Lord hath spoken it. Hallelujah. Praise God. As we are rushing to finish this morning, I'm sure you understand why we took this for a subject. That as we are believers, we don't have to forget one of those basic concepts or of basic principles of the word of God. Hallelujah. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all things shall be added unto you. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. These signs shall follow them that do what? That believes. Praise God. Not the signs going against belief, not the signs going against the character, not the signs going against ourselves, but the signs will follow if we believe, if we hearken, observe, and set our hearts to do what the Lord says. But prophet says, in one of the few quotations I'm going to quote this morning, the prophet says, when God first set the human race in or on earth, he told them to live by his word. Now, the word of God is like a chain. You are passing across hell with it. And its chain is only its best at its weakest link. And God wants us to keep every word of it. Now, that was the first of the Bible. Just to break one word plunged the human race into a darkness of death. So God had given Adam and Eve eternal life. They were living in eternal life as long as they observed the word of God, as long as they did what God said they must do. Now, brother and sister, there is some other things that we know the devil will always tend to condemn us. There is a scripture for every condition. And now this morning, I just want to remind you that there is a scripture for a sinner. There is a scripture for a backslidden man. There is a scripture for a person seeking the Holy Ghost. There is a scripture for every condition. A sick person. There is a scripture for a person who is looking for a job. There is a scripture for everything. And there is an instruction in the Bible. Like Pastor Abanda always wants to say, Bible represents basic instruction before leaving earth. There is a basic instruction for everything. So if you are backslidden, don't sit in a backslidden state and say, I'm backslidden, I failed to hearken the word of God, so I cannot do anything. Let me tell you, the Bible says, repent. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come and let us reason together. Even if your sins are as scarlet as red, I, which is the Lord God, will make them as white as snow. So there is a scripture for you, backslidden friend. There is a scripture for you, sinner brother. There is a scripture for you, for every one of us. There is a scripture for a preacher. There is a scripture for a priest. There is a scripture for every one of us. There is a scripture for you in the farms today. There is a scripture for you in the city today. There is a scripture for you who is jobless, who has no food today. There is a scripture for every one of us this morning. But listen very careful. Now, that was the first Bible. Just to break one word plunged the human race into a darkness of death. Now, I remember, he says in another message, and I remember when I was a little boy, and this is some of the children here at school and so forth. No matter if you are trying to do what's right, young men, young women, do that which is right, and God will bless you. Hallelujah. No matter what you are trying to do, do that which is right, and God will bless you. Do that which is right, and God will bless you. If you do that which is not right, God will withhold his blessings. God will withhold the honey in the rock. Praise God. Just allow me 5 more minutes as we conclude this message this morning. You can't be going this way when you are going this away. Always hold to the right. Do what is right, and you will come out right. I repeat again. Always hold to the right, do what is right, and you will come out right. That is from the message, the principles of divine healing. So there are principles of divine healing. Praise God. Hallelujah. Allow me to read the 3 last verses as we conclude this afternoon. Abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruits of itself except it abide in the vine, no more can ye except ye abide in me. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me ye can do nothing. I repeat the words of the Lord. For without me you can do nothing. We are absolutely going nowhere without the Lord Jesus Christ. When we choose our own ways, when we choose our own ways contrary to the word of God, when we refuse rebuke, correction, when we refuse guidance and leadership of the light of the word of God, we are going to do completely nothing. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch. The Lord is just repeating the same thing that Deuteronomy 28 is saying. If you don't abide in the Lord Jesus Christ, he will cast you off forth as a branch. He will just cut you off. He will cut off, and when you are no longer, when you are cut off, you are cut off from the blessings. You are cut off from the honey on the rock. You are cut off the splendorous milk of the land of Canaan. You are cut off from the Jerusalem blessings. You are cut off from Abraham's blessings. You are cut off from the blessings that are pronounced by the word of God. You are no longer heir to the inheritance of God. Hallelujah. In one quotation, Brother Branham says, never seek God's blessings when your life is not right with God. If a man abides not in me, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered. And men gather them and cast them into the fire. That's hell now for you. And they are burned. Hallelujah. If ye abide in me and my word abide in you, you shall ask what you will. You shall ask any blessing from God. You shall ask for any promise from God and shall be done unto you. If you keep my commandments and ye abide in me, if is a conjunction, if is a word of condition, hallelujah, if is a word that you must fulfill one part in order to get another part. So if is not saying and, it's if, praise God. If ye keep my commandment, ye shall abide in my love. And as I have kept my Father's commandments, and abide in his love. Allow me, friends, to close this ceremony with the words of the psalmist once more. We started with the psalmist, and we close with the psalmist this morning. Hallelujah. David says in the verse, which is found in Psalms 37, verse 25, he says, I have been young, and now am old. Yet I have not seen the righteous forsaken. If you don't want God to forsake you, keep his word. Abide in him, and he will abide in you. And in that day, you will ask anything that you will want from God, and God will grant to you. Hallelujah. Matthew 7, verse 7. Ask, and it shall be given unto you. Knock, and it shall be opened. Seek, and you shall find. All these promises to him that hearkens and abides to the word of God. He says, I am a healer. He says, I am a savior. He says, I am a messiah. God is a blesser. Praise God. But for you to be blessed of God, you have to abide by his word. And you have to follow, hearken, and seek. As I am repeating these words of King David, the most prosperous king, hallelujah, King David, the one who has that five star that is still being raised in Israel, hallelujah, he said, I've been young, and now I am old, yet I have not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. Friends, let us seek to hearken and to observe and to do what he said. And the blessings of God shall overtake us. Praise God. With these few words, friends, I say, God bless you richly, wherever you are, online, in your homes, on YouTube, on Facebook. God bless you. But only those blessings will come upon you if you hearken, if you and I, we seek to hearken and to follow the words of the living God. Shall we bow down our heads for a word of prayer? I also want to give special thanks to our precious brother Mseka and brother Blessing Nirapata for taking this time to make this online service a success. God bless you, saints. God bless you, saints, over those who have made it to listen. This message was meant to be listened. So I'll also say God bless you for being there to listen to it. It's coming from my heart. It's coming from the word of God. It's coming from the teaching of the prophet. God bless you. Shall we bow our heads for a word of prayer? Most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord God Almighty, I'd like to thank you, Father, for this moment you have granted to us. Dear Jesus Christ, we thank you for all the promises that you've made in the Bible. It's a truth that gracious God, whenever we are doing right, we are blessed. And Father, whenever we seek to do that which satisfies sometimes our flesh, sometimes, dear God, to please other people, Lord Almighty, or other gods, sometimes working under the instructions of devils, dear God, Father, enticed, seduced, dear God, Heavenly Father, oppressed by demonic powers, Father, we are living in a world of a curse. But God Almighty, when we seek to free our souls from the bondage of sin, dear God, to free our souls from the directives of the fifth dimension, which is the dimension of hell, Lord God Almighty, we know there is nothing that will stand in our way. Father, you even said it to Joshua, even as you said it also to Moses, even as you said to the prophet, that as I was with Moses, I will also be with you. And we believe that, Father, as you were with the prophet William Branham, you also be with us. As you were with the prophet Paul, you will be with us. As you were with Peter, you will be with us. Father, as you were with the children of Israel, you will also be with us. Help us that, gracious God, we may seek diligently your voice, Father, to live by it, to, Father, repent of our sins, to recant of our evil ways, to choose you, to ask for mercy, to beg for mercy, Father, a cleansing of our souls, dear God, to set our minds, our attitude, dear God, our goals right, to live according to the word of the living God, Father, at work, in church, in our families, in our homes, to our wives, to our husbands, to our children, Father, to our relatives, our parents, dear God, Father, to our fellowships, Father, we pray that, gracious God, may you help us, Father, to be true to your word, to be sincere to your word, dear God, and to live right. Help us, dear God. The challenges are so many. The world is wicked, Father. Lord God Almighty, Father, we see the corruption of the world in every corner, from politics, Father, employments, public services, whatever it might be, dear God, Father, we see, dear God, the corruption of the morals of our people, dear God, sometimes affecting even our morals as well. Father, we pray that, gracious God, may you help us to live according to your word, that, gracious God, all the promises and the blessings that are spoken of in the word will overcome us. Bless each and every one of us. Bless our brothers who are here with me this morning. Bless every believer, dear God, in the Heavenly Father, online, wherever we listen to this message. Father, may it be a meaning, may it be a wake-up call, not just to run without knowing where we are going, not to fight without knowing whom we are fighting against, not to expect, Father, without us setting conditions for us to be in expecting. We pray, bless us, dear God. Bless your children, those that are standing right. Father, we pray that, gracious God, may you bless them. Those who are struggling, may you come to their rescue, dear God. Those who are backslidden, may you bring them back to life, dear God. Those, Father, who are seeking salvation, healing, whatever in their heart desire, may you grant them, Father, this morning. For we ask it, Lord, in Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you, saints. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. We can give a clapping offering for sure to the Lord this morning. Hallelujah. God bless you. Meet you again next Sunday. We continue with our tape services in the middle of the week. We will turn and maybe we'll continue with broadcasting as we are seeing that there might not be a quick change to the lockdowns. Please, friends, be safe in places where you visit. Hallelujah. At workplaces, wear your masks according to their teaching. And sanitize, wash your hands, ensure you wash your foods, all that you can, avoid gatherings. God bless you. Amen. Thank you, saints. God bless you.